celebrating the connection with our pets. This is Animal Radio, featuring your dream team, veterinarian Dr. Debbie White and groomer Joey Villani. And here are your hosts, Hal Abrams and Judy Francis.
This is going to be a fun one today. You know, some days I feel like I could just call it in, right? I mean, frankly, that's... No,
really?
Nobody really feels like that. There's a day you don't want to go to work. Oh, come on.
There's lots
be honest.
Of days I don't want to go to work.
Today, I want to go to work.
This ain't work. Did you call this work?
Yeah.
Come groom a couple of dogs. I'll take you.
This is a lot of fun today. We have so many great guests. In fact, returning today is Debra Jo. Now, help me with this. Is it Chiapuzio?
Chiapuzio.
Chiapino?
Chiapuzio.
Chiapuzio. Chiapuzio. Is that right, Joey? Because you're the Chiapuzio. Token Italian here.
Sounds, you're the dog father.
I don't see why that's so hard.
I don't know.
It's Hal here.
But you remember her. She was on last year with the Emma Zen Foundation. Very charismatic young lady. And she'll be back this year. I think she's involved with pigs somehow.
Good for her.
We'll find out what that's all about. Also, a young lady who's sitting in a bathtub for how long is she?
I think she's going to do for 30 days, for a month, yes.
Sitting in a bathtub for 30 days. How many days has she been in?
It's almost over.
Oh, it is almost over. So she's been in the tub for almost 30 days. Why is she in a bathtub?
She's actually from New Zealand.
Oh, well, that explains it. Thank you.
No, she heard of...
Wait, is there water in the tub?
No, there's no water in the tub, but she...
Oh, there's no water in there.
No, but she heard about this. Lolita is a killer whale in Miami that lives in a small tank, and... You know, she felt sorry for this killer whale, and she kept, you know, waiting for somebody to do something, and no one was doing anything about it, and she thought, well, she's someone. So she flew over from Miami, and she's trying to raise awareness that keeping this killer whale in this tank is like a person living in a bathtub. There's not a lot of room, and they should release her back to the wild. So she's in front of, I don't know if it's SeaWorld or what place where this place... Where
no, it's Miami Sea Aquarium.
Miami Sea Aquarium.
Okay, so she's actually sitting outside in her tub outside in front trying to raise awareness and telling people as they go in.
Okay, so we're going to talk to her in just a few minutes right here on Animal Radio. Lori, what are you working on over there in the newsroom?
There's something new. It's called the Pet and Women's Safety Act, or PAWS Act.
Oh, I heard about this legislation.
You did?
Yeah, go on.
It's really cool. Well, it would be cooler if congressmen would jump on it and say, yay, we support safety for women and pets who are trying to flee abusive, you know, families. But they haven't done that yet. But we're going to tell you what it is about this PAWS Act that makes it so great, and hopefully we'll rally more support and get it passed soon.
Yeah, people don't realize that when there's domestic abuse situations with husbands and wives, oftentimes there's a pet involved, and the pet's very much at risk. We'll find out more about what this legislation is about coming up in just a few minutes. I also understand you're going to tell us about the Blue Buffalo lawsuit that is just being settled for $32 million? $32 million.
Class action lawsuit. Wow. Bunch of people. You know, the power of the people. You hear something and you feel kind of fooled, like somebody betrayed you. They say there's, you know, something this and this is great about the product, and then you find out by testing and research that it's not really true.
Ooh.
And, yeah, they took him to court.
False advertising. Okay, so we'll find out about that. This is especially important if you do use Blue Buffalo. And if you have, I believe you can be part of this class action lawsuit. And Lori will have all the details coming up in just a few minutes. We're going to head to the phones in just a second at 1-866-405-8405. Don't forget, you can also ask your questions from the Animal Radio app for iPhone and Android. Mr. Joey Villani, the dog father, what do you got on the show today?
We're going to talk about it. Is there a right way or a wrong way to brush your pet?
A right way or a wrong way to brush your pet?
Oh, yes.
I think I know the answer, but I'm going to wait because it sounds like a trick question to me. I'm just saying. That's on the way right here on Animal Radio. Let's go to the phones first. 1-866-405-8405, and we go to Robin. Hi, Robin.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm doing well, thank you.
I got the whole team here. What's going on with your animals?
Well, I have a pair of rather elderly dogs. One is full pug, and the other is a pug mix. I inherited them both, so I'm not positive about the ages, but I believe that my Barney is about 11, and the other one is probably about 9 or 10. The vet estimates a little bit older, but she is not great around the face. I think that probably that is correct or pretty close.
So what's going on with them?
I am facing a decision whether to have their teeth cleaned at this advanced age or not. So I had some tests made beforehand, and it revealed that the one has an enlarged heart, and she also has a little bit of congestion that I wanted to take care of before the procedure. The congestion seems to be disappearing with the medicine prescribed, which I have here. And the other dog, Barney, seems to have slight irregularity in liver reading. So he is taking some milk thistle and a Clavomax, I believe, for the in case the liver is inflamed.
So you're now, do we know, did the veterinarian identify some concerns with their mouths, or are you just thinking it would be a good idea to clean their teeth and you were looking into that?
No, I first started out wanting to get the teeth cleaned, and then I thought, you know, I need to run a test here on them to make sure that it's more than 50-50 chance that they'll do fine. So that's when these problems were revealed.
Okay. Yeah. Well, and, you know, the challenge here is for me with an, you know, the hard thing is to say on the phone, should you pursue this or not? Because, you know, really there's so much that goes into seeing a pet,
right,
evaluating them physically and knowing all the information. And I don't think I'm kind of in that short history privy to that. But I can tell you that, you know, we know that dental disease is a huge problem and that it does impact other systems of the body. Now, if the veterinarian in the course of your medical workup that they've done said, oh, gosh, you know, this looks like a problem. This could be a problem. This could be an abscess tooth. Then that might give me some more interest in why I would want to pursue a dental cleaning. If it's just a cosmetic thing and we're thinking everything looks great, they're not worried about gum disease, periodontal disease, then I think you do have to weigh that and really decide if it's in the pet's best interest. But I will tell you, senior pets in that age grouping, you know, a lot of them, if we do senior wellness testing and I do blood work and x-rays on the average pet that's 11 years of age, I'm going to find something. In at least 10% of the cases in a healthy pet, if we're doing senior wellness screening, we're going to find something, whether it's something like an enlarged heart. And an enlarged heart also has to be correlated with other things. You know, do we have a heart murmur? Do we have any symptoms of cardiovascular disease that are going on? So the presence of an enlarged heart by itself isn't something that necessarily stops me. But, you know, knowing all the other information, I think, is kind of how we base a decision on that. So I think that would be really the kind of the, I'd have a heart to heart with your veterinarian and say, okay, you know, I want to be a good mom. I want to pursue dental care. You know, what is the justification or how serious do you feel my pet's dental condition is, and if that's going to be in the pet's best interest? If they've never had a dental cleaning before, my guess is they probably do need it at that age, because if they haven't been getting regular dentistries and regular cleanings and evaluations, there is a very high possibility that things have already progressed to a more serious state when it comes to dental wise. So that's definitely something to consider. And, you know, the liver issue that you mentioned too, we also base that upon clinical symptoms. So if it's just something we notice on blood work, well, you know, there's other things we'll look at. We might screen for Cushing's disease. We might look for other underlying liver problems. Sometimes, like what your veterinarian is doing, we'll treat empirically with an antibiotic and a liver supplement, and then maybe reevaluate those liver values and see what
he does have him on milk thistle twice a day, 1 hour before eating.
Yeah, yeah.
Then he just recently prescribed the antibiotic. And I think the teeth are pretty bad, although the one I had been using, not too successfully, but a doggy toothpaste all along. And another vet who just retired had thought that he looked pretty good, but they don't look too good to me when we really take a good look at these gums.
Yeah. Well, and I know I've said this statistic before, but only 40% of what we see is what is going on with the teeth. The other 60% is under the gum line. Mm. And periodontal disease happens below the gum line. So it is very difficult to know what we're dealing with just by looking at the teeth. Mm-hmm. And that's why we can't replace regular dental care with your veterinarian with just doing home care. You can't just brush and feed special treats and think that that's going to replace the need for regular dental profies and cleanings.
Boy. Yes, I had been more diligent about it.
Yeah. Well, we learn as we go. And with each pet, we get a little bit better and we know more. Decades ago, dental care really didn't even receive attention much in the veterinary community. It was we waited till the teeth abscessed and then, golly, then we pulled a tooth. Now we know a lot better, and maintaining oral health translates into good health in the other organs and decreasing, you know, immune system issues and discomfort, you know, just having an infected or abscessed tooth is really uncomfortable. We know that. So.
Mm-hmm. How about this liquid that is added to the dog's drinking water that's advertised to control? Of course, at this point, I know mine would need more, but I'm just curious as to whether that is an effective treatment.
Well, there's a lot of different additives, so not all are the same. So there are certainly some that have been proven to help decrease tartar plaque accumulation. The one that comes to mind that we use in our practice is called Aquadent, and it has been shown by veterinary dentists to actually help decrease the rate of bacterial product accumulation on the teeth. Now, there are a lot of deodorizers that you may find on the market. Those are not the same kind of product. So I think we have to evaluate each one individually when someone asks about like these kind of things. And I do recommend.
I wasn't interested so much in the bad breath as the deterioration problem.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, there are, I will tell you, that for over-the-counter products, a lot of people, you know, when you're trying to investigate these, no, is it a good product or is it not going to be worth the money? If you buy it at your veterinarian's office, it's going to be, you know, obviously a endorsed product by that veterinarian. If you're buying something over-the-counter, we look for a seal. It's called the Veterinary Oral Health Council Seal, or VOHC.
Oh.
So that's one way that you can look at something. And, you know, granted, these rinses aren't going to do the same as having a cleaning at your vet or even brushing at home, but they can be a tool that you can integrate into your, you know, home health care for your pet.
I see. All right. Well, thank you. You have helped me look at some key issues to discuss with my veterinarian.
Mm. Okay. Well, best wishes to you and your babies there, Robin.
Thank you.
Toll-free 1-866-405-8405 to reach out to the Dream Team. You can also ask your questions from the free Animal Radio app for iPhone and Android, made free from Drs. Fosters and Smith. Download that puppy now. Well, this portion of Animal Radio is underwritten by World's Best Cat Litter. If you were like me, tired of wasting money on giant boxes of litter that don't last, do what I did. I switched to World's Best Cat Litter. This litter's got concentrated power so you use less and get more. Learn more over at tryworldsbest.com. And thanks, World's Best, for underwriting Animal Radio.
You're listening to Animal Radio. Call the Dream Team now at 1-866-405-8405.
Stella and Chewy's believes that selecting the best food is one of the most important decisions an owner can make for their pet. We believe that pets thrive when they're fed the same diet they'd get in the wild. Dogs and cats are carnivores, and meal mixers are a quick and convenient way to mix a little raw nutrition and great taste into their diet. Made from premium raw ingredients like grass-fed meat and cage-free poultry with organic fruits and vegetables, meal mixers help kickstart your kibble. Learn more at StellaandChewy's.com.
When's the best time to enjoy Twisted Tea?
Why don't we do a little day drinking?
The hard iced tea brewed like a beer that tastes like real iced tea because it's made with real iced tea. Hanging out at the pool, fishing with your buddy. Twisted Tea hard iced tea tastes great anytime. Cool, refreshing, smooth, but with a kick.
Why don't we do a little day drinking?
Twisted Tea, real iced tea taste with a kick.
Twisted Tea Brewing Company, Cincinnati, Ohio. Drink responsibly.
Before girls' night out, my eczema flared up. Ugh, I felt like canceling. But then I tried Cortisone 10 Eczema Relief, It's specially formulated for eczema and has 1% hydrocortisone, the strongest non-prescription itch medicine for fast, lasting itch relief. It quickly stopped the itch and soothed my red, dry, flaky skin. With Cortisone 10 Eczema Relief, I was ready for girls' night out, and it was the best one ever.
Cortisone 10 Eczema Relief. Feel the heal. Use as directed.
Geico applauds your inner road champion.
A solid bump from Geico's fist to yours goes out to the little rebel that lives within. The one who made you daydream as a kid about owning a chopper, chroming it out, and chewing on toothpicks. Just to look tough. For you, champ, Geico insures motorcycles with great rates. And to further fuel your engine, you can access your policy anytime, day or night, through the Geico mobile app. Because Geico knows that even make-believe renegades need help from time to time.
Geico Motorcycle. See how much you could save.
Hi, this is Mayim Bialik on Animal Radio. Please adopt a pet.
You're listening to Animal Radio. Call the Dream Team now at 1-866-405-8405.
Chiapuzio.
It's Animal Radio. And Hal here trying to make sense of this last name. I know we've had her on before. Debra Jo Chiapuzio will be on in just a few minutes.
Debra Jo what?
Chiapuzio.
Say it faster.
Chiapuzio.
If you say it fast enough, it doesn't matter how you pronounce it.
I know.
You might remember when she was on the last time talking about her foundation, the Emma Zen Foundation. Such a charismatic young gal. We just ran out of time, and so we figured we'd have her back. And I understand that she has adopted a pig as a pet.
A mini pig.
Mini pig.
Well, supposedly mini pig. You know how that goes.
Yeah, it could turn out to be one of those big 200-pound pigs.
Up to 300 pounds,
really?
Now. Yeah.
Oh, so we'll find out what it's like to adopt a pig and whether or not you should adopt a pig. You know, cat, dog, bird, pig.
Or whether
you know, what
pig
should it be?
Is the right pet for you.
Also on the show today, we're going to talk to Danielle Dahls. Is that her name? Danielle Dahls. And she's a young lady. How old is she? Do we know how old she is?
No.
29 years old.
Oh, she's 29. Okay.
It says it right here.
Yeah, I see that now.
She's been sitting in a bathtub for almost 30 days to raise awareness for Lolita, the killer whale at the Miami Seaquarium. She's protesting the small space that that killer whale is in by, I believe, hanging out in a bathtub.
Yeah, they say.
Yeah, I think Lolita has the smallest tank in the world.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Yeah, any captive orca.
And they say that they can swim up to 100 miles in the wild. And can you imagine that confined to the bathtub?
I just want to find out if she has all that pruny skin now. She's been in her bathtub for quite a while. So we'll find out in just a few minutes right here on Animal Radio. What are you working on over there in the newsroom, Miss Lori Brooks?
I have a story that's just kind of stumped me. I mean, this I'm going to tell you about a woman who thinks she's a cat, kind of like a day in her life.
Okay.
And, you know, there's all these little things about cats that you don't really think about, but take a few minutes and just observe your cat and really try and picture a human doing some of those things.
Okay. Well, I do remember Boomer. We had Boomer the dog on, who was a guy who thought he was a dog or thinks he's a dog.
Yep.
They
did
that Geo special, so now we have one that thinks she's a cat. Yep. And we'll find out.
It's trans species.
Trans species is what they call it.
Yes.
Okay, that's on the way right here on Animal Radio. I wanted to mention this. This is really important. There's been an estimated 70% rise on dog theft. Over 2 million pets were stolen last year. And most often this happens because there's profit to be made somewhere. Of course, you have the cases where there's the disgruntled spouse or somebody who takes the dog or deals with that. But in most cases, there are a lot of dogs that are being stolen right now. Most of them are the smaller dogs, you know, the little, where's that list here? Oh, yeah, the Yorkshire Terrier tops the list. The Pomeranian, the Maltese, and the Boston Terrier are also on that list. Among the large breeds of the most stolen dogs right now are Labrador Retrievers, Pit Bull Terriers, and Pit Bull Mixes. So if you have anyone, you know, it doesn't matter if you have one, any one of these animals, any animal that you have, you should make sure that they're supervised. Don't let them roam unsupervised. What happens if they're stolen? Well, unfortunately, there's what's known as Class B dealers, and these people collect pets across the country, and they sell them to research. That's one of the things that can happen. And let me tell you, if you have your animal spayed or neutered, these people in research, they don't want your animal. So that's just another reason to have your animal spayed or neutered. Pets are...
And if they're microchipped, can a lab accept them or a lab can't accept a microchip?
You know, I don't know the status on that. You may be right on that.
I don't think they can.
Yeah, I don't think they can.
Okay, so you want to definitely Make sure they're spayed or neutered and microchipped and always under your supervision. They are property, unfortunately. You know, to us, they're family. But in the eyes of the law, they're property. So anybody that steals your pet, it's just a spank on the hand. It's a misdemeanor as opposed to human kidnapping, which is a felony.
You know what? We talked about this before. And what they have to do, that's why they used to tattoo dogs.
Mm-hmm.
Usually like on the underbelly or on their shoulder or something. Dr. Debbie would know more about that.
Yeah.
But because the research labs could not accept a dog that was tattooed, because how could you miss seeing that tattoo?
Yep. Yep.
Yeah. Hey, you know, the other thing that I'd like to point out to our listeners is that a lot of people shop on Craigslist for animals.
Yep.
And that is actually one of the outlets where they sell these dogs. So someone may say, oh, I rescued this Pomeranian. I got online, you know, the people needed to rehome it. You know what? You know, we all want to believe the best story there. But this is actually a way that some of these thefts end up getting unloaded.
Human nature is ugly underneath. And Craigslist is a conduit for that. Whether you are trying to get rid of your pet, don't get rid of your pet on Craigslist for sure. If you need to get rid of your pet, for God's sakes, don't do it there, because that's where these Class B dealers look. And if you're looking for a pet, don't go to Craigslist. If you are getting rid of your pet for whatever reason, and I'm not here to judge you, but charge a price for it, and a good price, because dealers, these people, these Class B dealers, they don't want to pay for pets, and they often won't. The other thing that I hate to say is very unfortunate. Not only are dealers the recipients of these animals, but pit bull and dog fighting rings, they often use these animals, and cats, too. So I hate to say this, but do watch your animals and watch them very carefully. And I'm sorry that there's this underbelly of human existence that still is here, but better that you know about it before anything happens. Okay, we're going to head back to the phones after a quick check of the news. Toll free, 1-866-405-8405.
You're listening to Animal Radio. Call the Dream Team now at 1-866-405-8405.
This is an Animal Radio News Update, brought to you by Doctors Foster and Smith Pet Pharmacy, with prescription medications and over-the-counter products like Advantix Flea and Tick Medication delivered right to your door. Learn more at fosterandsmith.com.
I'm Lori Brooks. Think of all of the people and pets who have been injured even worse, too, by humans who are supposed to love and watch over them. You know, when it comes to domestic violence, we need to help those people. Well, fortunately, 30 states now allow judges to include pets in domestic violence protective orders, which simply means that someone can be ordered to have no contact with an animal which is owned by the person who is asking for their protective or restraining order. Now, on top of that, there is a federal bill in search of congressional support. It's the Pets and Women Safety, or PAWS Act, which will make it a crime to cross state lines to commit an act of domestic violence on a pet. Also, the grant part of that PAWS program would provide support for animal shelters to offer space for the pets of people who are fleeing domestic violence. They say offering those kinds of safe haven programs, that usually means finding a secret foster home where they can't be found. The supporters of the PAWS program say a state's borders will never stop abusers who mean to do harm, but why not give federal prosecutors one more tool to go after domestic violence perpetrators? You know what transgender means, of course. Well, now there's a 20-year-old Norwegian woman who I guess would be, I don't know, you call it trans species, maybe? Nano, as she likes to be called, claims she was born in the wrong species and that she is actually a cat trapped in a human body. Now, she says her personality and psychological features prove that she is more feline than human because she prefers walking around on her hands and knees, you know, instead of standing up on two legs like humans prefer to walk. And she likes to, get this, sleep in a sink or on a windowsill, despite her average adult size. She also claims that she possesses a slew of cat-like characteristics. For instance, ultra-sharp hearing, laser night vision, and fierce aversions to both dogs and, of course, the dreaded water. The clincher now that Nano is really a cat, you can see this for yourself in her YouTube video, in which she says, "It's also obvious that I'm a cat when I start purring and meowing. Sometimes I hiss when I meet dogs on the street." I'm Lori Brooks. Get more breaking animal news anytime you need it at animalradio.com.
This has been an Animal Radio News Update brought to you by Doctors Foster and Smith Pet Pharmacy. With everyday low prices on products like Quellen and Rimadyl delivered right to your door with a 100% satisfaction guarantee. Learn more at fosterandsmith.com.
Doctors Foster and Smith Pet Supplies have a Vet VIPPS accredited online pharmacy covering all your pet's needs, from heartworm medications and anti-inflammatories like Rimadyl to non-prescription items like Canine Advantix Flea and Tick Preventive. Doctors Foster and Smith has your pet covered. We'll even contact your vet for you, all with a 100% satisfaction guarantee. Low prices every day with free shipping on orders over $49. Shop online at fosterandsmith.com because your pet's health and happiness come first.
Did you know canine caviar diets are formulated with common health concerns in mind, such as diabetes, cancer, and kidney disease? You see, canine caviar uses low GI carbs, which reduce hunger and prolong physical endurance. Free of GMO, gluten, hormones, steroids, and antibiotics, canine caviar's five-star dog and cat foods are the only alkaline-based foods in the world, and that promotes a healthy lifestyle for your furry family. Find out more at caninecaviar.com.
You're listening to Animal Radio. If you missed any part of today's show, visit us at animalradio.com or download the Animal Radio app for iPhone and Android.
How you're confusing me.
Chiapuzio. Come on. Nice,
I know. How hard is that?
See, I'm saying like Joey's saying it.
Chiapuzio. Joey's got it.
Joey's got it. Joey would know it. And I'm saying it like Joey. Chiapuzio. Right? Chiapuzio.
Italian.
No, it's a J, but it's
Chiapuzio.
I just love the name, and you know what? I could just sit here for a half an hour just saying Chiapuzio. Just because it just sounds good. It's like
it does.
You know what?
It has action when you say it.
There are two words in the English language: that and mahogany. Put those two together.
Don't
you like the word mahogany?
You know, that's a good name, Mahogany Chiapuzio.
I'm telling
mahogany
you,
Mahogany Chiapuzio.
For your next,
my next pig.
Yes. There so what? Go. What's the deal? You're dealing with pigs now, Debra Jo Chiapuzio. By the way, joining us here, if you haven't guessed, you have pigs now.
No, I have a pig. Got into, I guess, the same desire that a lot of people have right now, and I wanted to get a mini pig, and I did. However, I went into it a little bit more educated, knowing that my mini pig could be anywhere from, you know, 150 to 300 pounds.
Now, why did you pick a pig, just asking?
Do you know, it was like one of the only animals I never had growing up as a child.
Okay.
Most girls want a horse, but, you know.
Yeah, I had those. Okay. I had horses and cows and donkeys. I just was lacking the swine.
I heard they're pretty smart.
They're very smart. You can teach them a trick the way you can a dog and teach them a command. But where I find them to be more intelligent is to take those behaviors that are either taught or that they have innately and kind of link them together to get what they want. So to me, that takes a kind of a level of intelligence. And I think that it is their smarts where a lot of people end up having to put them into shelters, because they need to use their brain every day. And so if you don't provide some kind of enrichment, it's behavior that you end up seeing as bad behavior.
They'll eat everything in the house if you don't keep them busy, right?
Yes, including the barstool chairs.
Sounds like personal experience.
Personal experience, the three-legged table. Would you like me to go on?
You know, I don't think that's the only reason they end up as shelters, is that they're not challenged. I think that, like you said, people get these mini pigs thinking they're going to be like 25, 30 pounds, and they can be up to 300 pounds,
yes,
and
they can't deal with them. Baby Banks is actually sort of a smaller mini pig, and she actually weighs 135.
Wow.
That's still pretty big.
That's a big
pig. Yes, it is.
Yeah.
Now, I let my dogs and cats sleep in the bed with me. Do you let your pig sleep in the bed with you?
Oh, I knew you were going to ask that question. Yes, the pig sleeps in the bed with us.
Oh, no.
Pig in a blanket. I'm telling you, that part is true.
Do pigs snore?
No, but they do kind of twitch a little bit in their sleep the way a dog does when it's dreaming. They have a little snout twitch that's really cute.
Are pigs really dirty?
You know, I think that that is a very old phrase that came from the farmers in the days where pigs were livestock and on farms and they're outdoors and it's raining and they get muck in their pens, because she is actually the cleanest animal that I think I've ever owned. They potty train themselves. They go outside like a dog to go to the bathroom. They go in the same place. They come back in. They want their bed to be neat. She doesn't even want food in her bed. And she doesn't smell. She doesn't have an odor. Like dogs all, even if it's not a bad odor, dogs have a particular odor to their fur or their paws. You know, we've all heard that they smell like Fritos. Or,
so does she self-groom?
More often than not.
Well, you have dogs, too. Does the pig think she's a dog?
Well, I think that's probably one of the biggest reasons that the rescues are filling up. Yes, it's the weight that people don't understand how big they're going to be. And the other one is social media. All these cute little pictures of the pig and the pig's face and, you know, sitting next to your dog. And when in reality, they're prey animals.
Oh, really?
So, you know, you should never leave a dog and a pig alone together, even if you think your animals get along. I never leave my dog, Emma Zen, and Baby Banks alone, because in the wild, they are prey animals. So if they're laying on their side, they jump up fast so that they can run away, and that is that instinct is always in them. And if it wants to challenge everybody, the dog, the cat, the humans, you know, every couple of weeks, just to see if she still lies at the bottom of the hierarchy. So if you weren't home and she challenged your dog and your dog had just about had enough of the pig in its face, you may come home to an earless pig or even worse.
Would you recommend a pig as a pet?
I would recommend a pig for a pet for a person who was ready to take on the responsibilities for a lifetime of that animal. You have to understand that one of the number one things that they do is root. So if you decide you want a pig, you can't get upset when you no longer have a pristine backyard, you no longer have anything in your planters. And if that's not going to work for you, then I don't think that you should adopt a pig to begin with.
Are there such things as pig rescues? Can I go to some place and just find a pig?
Yes, you can. There are. In fact, the rescues are overflowing right now because they're popular again like they were in the 80s.
You have the food trade going on now, the food train. What is that?
I just can't stop. In short, what it is we ask for the public to support it through public donation. It is a nonprofit. We then purchase the food, and some of that is in form of the pellets that pigs eat or maybe some of the fresh vegetables that they need, and then we deliver it to those specific organizations and rescues that have been housing these researched saved laboratory animals.
Well, that's great, and the website is thefoodtrain.org, and this is for all pigs, right?
Correct.
Okay, check out thefoodtrain.org and, of course, the emmazenfoundation.com. We'll put links to everything you've heard on today's show over at animalradio.com. And, yes, we need to do this once again. Debra Jo Chiapuzio.
Chiapuzio. Say it with me.
Chiapuzio. Oh,
there
I just love
go.
It.
Thank you very much. It's been wonderful talking to you today.
We'll talk again. 1-866-405-8405. She's a hottie. Can I hold up her picture?
Lots of energy.
Lots of energy.
I think I like pigs, too.
Have you seen the tattoos up and down her arm there? Check this out.
She's got more tattoos than you, Joey.
Yes, she does.
And I like pigs, too.
It is time for the dog father, Joey Volani, on Animal Radio, as the violin players have signified. How are you doing, Joey?
I'm wonderful. If I was any better, I'd be Judy.
That's probably true.
I'm good.
But anyway, I got a great email this week from someone. And sometimes when you're a professional, you take certain things for granted. And one really simple question, is there a right way and a wrong way to brush my pet, meaning dog or cat? And there absolutely is. You want to make sure you have the right brush. And what you don't want to do is go against the way the coat grows. And a lot of people want to do that because they get a lot of hair out, you know, real quick, and it seems to work real easy. The problem is you're doing two things. Number one, usually your pet doesn't like that because it's pulling and tugging and probably hurting a little bit. The other thing is you're getting a lot of hair breakage, and that doesn't always look good on your pet. Always brush and comb the way the coat lies, okay? And I never brush real hard. I always use the weight of the brush, and that's it. And you're going to brush in a 2-inch section at a time, constantly overlapping. So I'll do a 2-inch area. I'll take my comb. I'll go through that area to make sure there's no knots, tangles, or shedding coat. And then I'll overlap a little bit, do another 2-inch section. Comb, 2-inch section, comb. Now, it seems a little redundant, but you know what? Once you understand your pet's coat, you know, then you could take those shortcuts where you know that you're covering everything. But if you want to be thorough, that's how I would do it. And again, go with the lie of the coat. And a couple of things happen. Number one, eventually you get all that undercoat out. And number two, your pet's coat is always going to look wonderful.
It's like redoing furniture, Judy. You go with the grain.
Yes, you got to follow the grain
on that. Okay.
Well, are you guys redoing furniture that came up?
Yeah, as a matter of fact.
I am, yes.
Well, we try not to confuse the animals with the furniture, although you do the same direction.
Yes. But it's a good analogy, so you never know. If somebody knows furniture better than animals, you know, now they can relate.
Don't go against the grain.
Okay, 1-866-405-8405, the show that's always going against the grain. It is Animal Radio as we celebrate the connection with your pets. One more time, much slower, 1-866-405-8405. Every time I rattle it off, Guido looks at me and he goes, hey, no one can hear that. No one hears that.
Slow down.
I wish it spelled something, you know?
Yeah, that would make it a lot easier.
Other than Kefligana. That's hard to remember.
I always think of 405 as the San Diego Freeway in Southern California.
There you go.
Notorious traffic.
There you go. Yeah. We're just about as plugged up as the 405, too. Let's go back to the phones. Now, remember, you can ask your questions from the Animal Radio app for iPhone and Android also. So download that if you can't get through on the phones today.
Dogs or cats, horse or emu, animals are people too.
6 months after adopting their dog, a Michigan couple noticed that their chocolate lab, Remington, didn't seem to be as playful. Kelly and Scott Cornelise said their usually active dog didn't seem to want to play or even move. Scott noticed what he thought might be a lump, possibly a broken rib, and brought Remington to the vet. Imagine their surprise when an x-ray showed an 8.5-inch aluminum arrow shaft lodged in Remington's chest. The arrow, which might have been there for some time, had entered just under his armpit, just missing his heart. Dr. Stephen Harden donated his services for the unusual case and removed the arrow. Remington is now on his way to recovery, thanks to their vet with a big heart. I'm Britt Savage for Animal Radio.
Are people too. Animal Radio.
Well, this portion of Animal Radio is underwritten by Stella and Chewy's. You know, pets thrive when they're fed the same food they'd get in the wild. And meal mixers are an easy, convenient way to add raw, nutrient-rich meat, wholesome fruits, vegetables, probiotics, and antioxidants to your dog's diet. You can learn more over at stellaandchewys.com. And thank you so much for underwriting this portion of Animal Radio. Cleveland, Ohio. John, you are on with Dr. Debbie.
Hi, Dr. Debbie.
Well, hi there. How are you today?
Good. I have a yellow lab. He's around one year, 2 months. He's scratching, and I rescued him from the pound about 6 months ago, and he had fleas when I got him. So I was wondering, I don't see any fleas. I was giving them front lines, but I don't know if I should continue doing that or if there's something I maybe can give him a bath.
With the itching and scratching, does he have any areas where he's losing hair? Do you see any spots of irritation, anything like that?
No.
It's just that he does an itching repeatedly. How often would you say he's itching?
He scratches probably sometimes 3 or 4 times in the evening. But it's a lot because a friend of mine noticed.
Well, definitely with a history of fleas and even being in an environment where you have fleas throughout the year, that would be definitely something I would work very hard at making sure that we treat that as fully as possible. Because one single flea can create the itch cycle for a long time. And especially for some animals who are allergic to that flea saliva, that makes that itch even worse for them. So I would continue with frontline. But, you know, there's some simple things you can do. I would go to the lower back area right in front of the tail, and I would look for evidence of fleas, because if you've got fleas, that's going to be where I'm going to tell you to focus your efforts. And what you're going to be looking for is actually the little critters themselves, but also for basically flea poop, which looks like pepper. And if you see anything like that along his skin, and it just fleas kind of like that area in the lower back on dogs, then definitely I would go full guns after the fleas. And you may need to actually see your veterinarian for some other tips and tools, because there are other medications that we may use as well. But if right now I could stand there and look at your baby and say that there's no fleas and that's not playing a role, being a Labrador, they do tend to have, you know, a lot of kind of allergic skin diseases. So things like supplements such as fatty acids can be helpful for mild allergies. May not stop the itch completely, but can help with just general dryness and improve the overall coat and be kind of a natural anti-inflammatory. And a young dog who itches also makes me think about the possibility of a food allergy. And very young Labradors, if I start to see them scratching and itching, and I'm not finding evidence of fleas or other types of critters, then I will definitely talk about getting them on a food that is designed for pets with allergies. Some of those may be based from different protein sources, like duck, venison. But basically, for some of these guys, they're just kind of... their skin's wired a little bit differently. We need to come at it a little differently. So I would definitely see about trying a food trial with the hypoallergenic food for him.
Okay. What is something good to, like, maybe bathe him in? Is there something that you can do at home?
Yeah, for bathing, if there's nothing actively going on as far as an infection on the skin, a good general all-around kind of anti-itch shampoo is going to be something oatmeal-based. Doesn't have to be medicated, and we wouldn't want to use something medicated unless we actually have that problem present. So you can go over the counter, go to your favorite pet store or your veterinary office, and get an oatmeal-based shampoo and even a conditioner. And a lot of the kind of leave-on conditioners can have a nice soothing effect for several days. It'll wear off, but it's something you can do at home to kind of make them feel better. It's kind of like a doggy Aveeno bath, if you will. So that might help make them a little bit more comfortable as well. So I say give that a whirl, John. You know, and I'm a Labrador lover myself, and one of my little babies has a lot of skin-related problems. So I'm kind of always... he's one step ahead of me, and I'm always trying to catch up and treat that skin. So keep up every effort you can, and you'll get them there.
Toll free, 1-866-405-8405. You know, this is radio, and most of you don't have to suffer what we suffer here in the studios. Oftentimes, well, we have faces for radio, let's just put it that way.
How?
And we have smells for radio, too.
Okay, you got that one.
Especially the dogs. But not today. I noticed that Ladybug smells like lavender.
You know what? That's the Purple Rain Calm and Clean Lavender Shampoo from Lucy Pet Products.
Well, I should have guessed that.
I know. You know, sometimes you'll see that she smells like coconut, or she'll smell like blueberry or apple. I switch it up. I bathe her once a week, and I like to switch it up once a week.
It's good stuff. It smells good, and her coat looks so shiny clean.
Oh, it's so healthy for her, too. The little leave-in conditioner just really, not only does it smell good, and I can use it in between baths just to give her that fresh smell, but it's actually conditions her coat as well and makes it nice and soft and shiny.
And the best part is the studio does not stink of dog today.
And I have to say, these containers are so pretty to look at. You want to keep them out. I have them sitting out on my counter because... they're beautiful. I love all the different colors.
Well, you know, the Lucy Pet Foundation, not only do they create a great shampoo, that just looks good on the shelf, too. But Lucy Pet Products supports the Lucy Pet Foundation, which is a 501c3. It's a registered animal charity whose mission is to reduce pet overpopulation and support causes that benefit animal welfare, just like Animal Radio, including Animal Radio.
And I have to say, it's not a portion of the proceeds that go to the foundation. It's 100%.
The whole deal.
The whole deal. All the money made goes to the foundation to support animal causes.
Win-win all around. Ladybug smells like lavender. Studio smells great. And the Lucy Pet Foundation is helping animals with your dollars. Thought you should know. You can get Lucy Pet products over at Petco or your independent pet store.
Celebrating the connection with our pets. This is Animal Radio, featuring your dream team, veterinarian Dr. Debbie White and groomer Joey Villani. And here are your hosts, Hal Abrams and Judy Francis.
Wow. The show has been packed up to now, and it continues to be packed. This hour, We're going to talk to this young lady who's hanging out in a bathtub. She's been there for almost 30 days doing that to raise awareness about the killer whale Lolita at the Miami Sea Aquarium. And we're just trying to get in touch with her right now and find out how it's been and what day she's at and if her skin's all pruny and all that kind of stuff.
Gosh, that would be very uncomfortable.
Yes.
You know, I slept in a doghouse.
Not for 30 days.
I always
days.
Think of you when I hear people doing stuff like this. That takes a lot of passion. I admire that.
I think what she's doing is awesome. And, you know, when you're 29 years old, you can do that, but not at my age. Too old now. Lori, over there in the newsroom with no animals today. I don't see any animals in the newsroom. Are they hiding under the desk? No?
Well, it's been pretty quiet in here, hasn't it?
It sure has.
No, they're all at home today.
Okay.
Now, I'm going to be telling you about the blue buffalo, which is hard to say fast.
Blue buffalo.
The blue buffalo class action lawsuit settlement, $32 million, and how you might be entitled to getting a little share of that yourself.
Now, I heard that you had to have the receipts for buying this food in order to get part of that class action suit.
No.
That's not true?
It helps if you have the receipt, but you don't have to.
Okay, that's on the way. So if you have fed your dog blue buffalo or do feed your dog blue buffalo, a class action lawsuit was settled, and Lori will tell you all about it in just a couple of minutes right here on Animal Radio. But let's go to the phones first. Let's go to Sue. Hi, Sue. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Good. Where are you calling from today?
I'm actually calling from Driftwood, Texas.
Driftwood, Texas. That sounds so, I just picture nothing. Dust.
Driftwood.
Driftwood and a tumbleweed rolling across.
Yeah. It's got trees like California, actually.
Oh, well, then it's probably very pretty. What's going on? Do you have troubles with your animals? I got the whole team here for you.
Oh, well, good. Yeah, we moved onto a property, and there were four cats, and we've adopted them all. And they're outside cats, and they have ear mites. We took one to the vet, and she got a product that kills four things at once. And I'm thinking, I think you have to do it every month. And it's like, gee, four times $20, that's $80 just for medication. And it's like, I can't do that. So I'm trying to figure out what in the world I can do. I know there's two different pesticides. I've heard mineral oil might work. And then the bedding, how often do I change the bedding? Because they sleep in a converted doghouse with hay, so it's warmer in the winter. I just don't know what I should do.
Okay. So do these cats come inside at all, or are they pretty much, they're just outdoor cats that you just take care of?
They are just outdoor cats.
Okay. And then do they interact with any pets of your own that you already have?
No.
Okay. And did the veterinarian that saw your kitty, did they actually see ear mites on a sample and say, I looked under the microscope and I saw this creepy crawler?
Yes, they did.
Perfect. Great, because that's really important, because ear mites are definitely one of the most common causes of ear infection in cats, but it's not the only one. So we always do want to make sure we do really see those creepy crawlers in there. So a couple things. First of all, ear mites pretty much live on and near an animal's ears. So if we have dogs, cats, rabbits, ferrets all sharing the same living space, and they're sharing close quarters, cuddling up to each other, having contact, we do worry about that contamination between animals. But generally, these kind of mites don't live in the environment. They just really like to stay close to their meal, and their whole life cycle is really quite close in the ear environment. In fact, people don't really even get any kind of symptoms with ear mites. There's only been some, rare cases of people getting skin irritation. So most of your efforts are really going to be on the cats. And that can be tough because with outdoor cats, they are in an environment. They may be encountering other cats as well, which could reinfest them. So in normal closed household situations, we treat for ear mites. And we're very comfortable that if we treat effectively, we treat the whole group of animals, we're going to get control of this. But you may run into some problems because you do have this outdoor cat scenario. Now, I don't see a harm in kind of cleaning the bedding and things like that within the cat house, if you will. But I don't think that's going to be something you really need to spend a lot of extra efforts on.
Okay.
And let me ask you, are all the cats fairly tame? Are you able to handle them on a daily basis? Or is it something you...
Yes, I can.
Okay.
All
so
of them.
Some... And that depends what kind of product we might use as well. There are some fabulous products that you can use as a spot-on product, and we typically will use those about once a month. And that may be what one of the products that your veterinarian got for you. Was it the Advantage Multi?
It was Revolution.
Revolution. Okay. And Revolution is one that I typically use quite a bit for cats with ear mites. And the trick is to treat all the kitties. So that would be a fabulous product you can use. You know, normally one treatment is all we need to do, but sometimes I'll do a second just to be on the safe side. But you do mention, you know, mineral oil, and that is actually kind of one of the cheap home care tips that you can use for ear mites in dogs and cats. Is we can use mineral oil, vegetable oil, sometimes olive oil we'll use. And the idea is you basically put enough in the ear canal that you're going to be coating and basically smothering the mites. The downside to that is it has to be done once a day, pretty much for 3 weeks in a row. So that's why if you can't catch the cats, it could be a tough thing and a very messy thing. So I have to say, it's not something I typically recommend for folks, even though it's cheap and readily available. It has to be done frequently. The cats get kind of tired of the whole thing. So for me, I do like the monthly spot-ons. There also are some other topical products. There is a ivermectin-containing ear drop that you can get from your veterinarian, and that usually you can treat once in the ears, and then I usually repeat it 2 weeks later. And that might be something that might be a little bit more economically friendly for you, that you can use, and you can use that on all the kitties, and you only have to apply it a few times, so it's not like you're, you know, having to catch them every day. So that might be the other type of...
Yeah, that sounds attractive, that's for sure. I don't want to do it every day.
Yes. And I applaud you for taking care of these kitties and, you know, hopefully also take care of some of the other things that they might need, like some basic rabies vaccinations, things like that, just to keep them safe.
Oh, yeah. And two of them are getting spayed tomorrow.
Oh, awesome. Good.
That's so what was this product that you... that I could get?
Yes, the one brand name that I use is called Acarex. It's A-C-A-R-E-X-X.
Okay.
And it's an ivermectin-containing topical that you put in the ears.
All right, and you put it in, like, once every 2 weeks?
Mm-hmm, yep.
Now, should I be doing this once every 2 weeks forever?
Well, we wouldn't typically do it forever. It's not something I would typically recommend, but I would definitely do it initially. Try to make sure if you can follow up with a veterinarian, if it looks like we've got complete treatment, and then it may be something throughout the year you do intermittently if we're worried about infestations or reinfestations.
Okay. All right. And then, you know what? I've put some mineral oil in their ears a week ago. Mm-hmm. And so then if I put this Acarex in there, is the oil going to render it ineffective?
Well, it depends on how much oil is in the ears currently. But, yeah, if they're already lubed up and if you were already, say, doing the mineral oil for, you know, many days or weeks, yeah, you're going to have a lot of gunk in there and you're going to probably want to have those ears cleaned out or at least give it some time for the residual stuff to come out of there.
Okay. Is it necessary that I clean out their ears?
Well, just don't want to have a ton of oil or waxy product in there.
Okay. All right.
Sounds like you got some answers there. I hope that helps. Hey, let us know.
Oh, my gosh.
If you're still having problems, Sue, in a few weeks, let us know, and I'd like to do a follow-up, okay?
Okay. All right. Thank you so very much. I appreciate the help.
Of course. Thanks for listening. Toll free, it's 1-866-405-8405 to reach out to the Dream Team right now, Dr. Debbie or Joy Villani. Well, this healthy serving of Animal Radio is brought to you by the grain-free Red Barn Naturals canned food for dogs and cats, always made in the USA with natural, functional ingredients to support your pet's optimal health. Learn more over at redbarninc.com. And thanks, Red Barn, for underwriting Animal Radio. Toll free 1-866-405-8405 to any one of the Dream Team, the dog father Joey Villani and veterinarian Dr. Debbie. Right now for Dr. Debbie, we have Tricia. Hi, Tricia.
Hey, how are you doing?
Good. Where are you calling from?
Raleigh, North Carolina.
Is it a beautiful day there in Raleigh?
It's a little chilly, but it's typical for this location of this type of year.
So what's going on with your animals? Do you have a dog?
Oh, I have two ratties. In fact, I had talked to you guys a couple of years ago. I have two ratties, rat terriers.
a mini breed. Uh-huh. The one that I'm concerned about is a rescue. And she's supposedly around six, that's her guesstimation, but she's graying in her face more than Petey, the older one. But this is what's going on. It appears that when I take them for a walk, now Chloe is spayed, so what I've been noticing, and I can't see it all the time, obviously, with the ground, but you know how dogs like barking. Well, there's times it looks like she might be straining. I mean, there's nothing left to mark with. But I did notice last week that on a leaf that appeared to be blood.
Okay.
It
does not, oh, boy.
It's kind of bloodish tone. But she has, it doesn't happen all the time, or that I cannot see it all the time. That I was wondering what.
Absolutely. So, Tricia, let me ask you, with your little girl, does she have any accidents in the house?
She does on occasion. Not always, but there's been spurts that, like, really? We're getting up in the morning, we have a routine, and I'm a firm believer of the routine, and they're created during the day. Mm-hmm. And, but there's occasionally that, even before I even get downstairs, ta-da! Look at what I left him on.
And has that been something she's always done, or is that just recent? Okay.
It's sporadic, and it's only been sporadic within the last 6-8 months. But I know that I had seen some, it was before that, but here again, I can't find a rhyme or reason. One of the few times that I have seen the red in the spotting.
Okay, well, I'm going to tell you, in a spayed female dog that is having red discoloration in her urine, it's never normal. So this is definitely something she needs to see a veterinarian for. And the things that come to mind when I hear this, and especially kind of more of a chronic problem where maybe she has these accidents and maybe occasionally you see blood, but it's not always a persistent thing. For me, I'd really make sure we check her out for some urinary stones. That's kind of the first thing that really comes to mind. A urinary infection is also possible, but usually, with at least more severe infections, it's pretty kind of hits them pretty hard and fast. So just like us, if we have a urinary infection, there's urgency. You got to run to the bathroom. You're uncomfortable. So the symptoms are kind of hit you all, you know, relatively fast. So that's what's making me think that maybe this might be something more of a urinary calculus or a stone of some sort, that it can be kind of intermittent and not so severe that it's kind of doubling her over or sending her running out the doggy door every minute. There are also some other things that can crop up in the urinary tract, whether there are polyps or types of tumors. So, you know, those might be other things to consider. But for me, I'd say we need to get a urine sample, and I would probably get an X-ray to look and see if we've got any potential stones showing up. But, definitely need to get this gal in there.
I thought so, but it's easier to get a hold of you guys than trying to get an appointment and not know what direction I'm being led to unnecessarily.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's a great point, is you don't want to have things done that aren't necessary. But I can tell you, from what you're saying, this gal definitely needs a urine sample, and I would say even an X-ray. And when you do make that appointment, one important thing that I could tell pet owners is, really, if you've got a urinary-type symptom going on, you don't want her to go to the bathroom right out front at the veterinary office. You want to have her crossing her legs when she walks in, because it's going to make things a little bit easier for the veterinary staff if she's not just gone and eliminated everything out of her bladder.
Yeah, see, that's the hard. How do you do that without having an accident in the car, right? And, you know.
Well, most of it is just not. A lot of people, the first thing you do when you get to the vet office is you go right to that grassy spot. So that's basically what we'd ask you not to do, is just, you know, just get her right in the door. Don't stop at any places where she kind of sniffs and wants to pick up on other scents. You just get her in that door. So other than that, that's about the best you can do.
Yeah, carry the sucker in. Fortunately, being 7 to 10 pounds, that's easy.
That's a benefit. Yeah, they're portable.
Yeah. Well, thank
good
you
luck
so
with
much.
That.
And I love listening to you guys, because I was disappointed. In fact, I canceled XM Radio because I couldn't get you guys, and now I can get you on Heart Radio. So that was a huge blessing.
Good for you, Tricia.
I love y'all.
Hey, if Tricia can do it, anybody can do it. Make that switch on over to iHeartRadio right now. We appreciate it. We love listening to you. So anytime you want to call, 1-866-405-8405.
You're listening to Animal Radio. Call the Dream Team now at 1-866-405-8405.
People say less is more. At Red Barn, we think less is better. It's what you won't find that sets our natural premium pet food apart. No byproducts, no corn or soy, no fillers. Just the natural ingredients your pets need to live the healthy life they deserve. Look at the label. We want you to. Red Barn Naturals Pet Food. Simply the best. Find it in your local pet specialty store. Red Barn canned food for cats and dogs is grain and gluten-free.
I am the family dog. And it's that time of year again. The one where pet parents start looking for Fido-friendly hotels and destinations where Fido is welcome. Make no bones about it. Pets are part of the family, and we like to sniff out new places too. And we hate to be turned away, especially when we're on our best behavior. So we won't be left out in the cold. Be sure to pick up a copy of Fido-friendly magazine to find the best hotels and destinations where Fido is always welcome. Go online to FidoFriendly.com and subscribe today.
Remember when a small business needed a landline? Today, landlines are a thing of the past with Grasshopper, the entrepreneur's phone system. On the road, at the beach, or at home, Grasshopper helps you grow your business. Get all the features of a business phone system and the freedom of a cell phone with our iPhone and Android apps. Features include multiple extensions for your team, calls forwarded to your mobile phones, voicemails transcribed and emailed, and so much more. See how it works at grasshopper.com, the entrepreneur's phone system.
When's the best time to enjoy Twisted Tea?
Why don't we do a little day drinking?
The hard iced tea brewed like a beer that tastes like real iced tea because it's made with real iced tea. Hanging out at the pool, fishing with your buddy. Twisted Tea hard iced tea tastes great anytime. Cool, refreshing, smooth, but with a kick.
Why don't we do a little day drinking?
Twisted Tea, real iced tea taste with a kick.
Twisted Tea Brewing Company, Cincinnati, Ohio. Drink responsibly.
Hi, this is Paul Reiser, and you're listening to Animal Radio. Every minute you're here, you're not harming someone else. I don't know what that means. If it's usable, use it. Otherwise, cut it and get out.
You're listening to Animal Radio. If you missed any part of today's show, visit us at animalradio.com or download the Animal Radio app for iPhone and Android.
Radio, celebrating the connection with our pets. Toll free. Here's the number, 1-866-405-8405. And don't forget, you can also ask your questions from the Animal Radio app for iPhone and Android. If you happen to have a Yorkshire Terrier, a Shih Tzu, a Pug, or a Mini Schnauzer, don't forget our very own Dr. Debbie has her Kindle ebooks available over at Amazon, How to Be Your Dog's Best Friend. And we have links to everything you've heard on today's show over at animalradio.com. In a few minutes, we're supposed to talk to this young lady, 29-year-old young lady, who's been in a bathtub for almost 30 days in front of, I believe, the Miami Sea Aquarium. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And she's trying to bring attention to the killer whale, Lolita, who's been in captivity there in a very, very small tank. Which
I
seems
think it's the smallest tank in the world.
I'm looking at a picture of it, and if that's the tank that she's in, it is. I can say it's probably as big as my house, which is small. I live in a very little cottage. And so it is a small place. And we'll find out exactly what her deal is. I believe we've been trying to call her a couple of times. And I hope she's okay.
Yep.
You don't think she drowned or anything, do you?
Well, is there actually a phone that can reach into her bathtub? Maybe it's like out on some public display here.
What is that?
She can't get a phone.
It's her cell phone.
It's her cell phone.
Her cell. Yeah.
Maybe,
okay.
Maybe she hasn't charged it or something like that.
Maybe.
Okay. Well, hopefully she'll be on the show before we leave today because I want to find out what kind of nut butt does that kind of stuff. I would do that kind of stuff. Anything to bring attention to.
Yeah, how many days did you sleep in a doghouse to
I did it twice.
Bring awareness to shelter dogs?
And not 30
days.
I didn't
hear about that. How long did you do, Hal?
A little over a week once and then a week another
wow.
time. And it was fun. I actually had fun because they brought the shelter dogs out, and so the shelter dogs and me were buds for a week. We got to hang out.
Did you have to defend your territory with any of them?
No, I didn't.
You didn't pee on like the side of the house or anything like that to keep them away?
He marked it before they came. He had it all marked before anyone came out.
I will say that we were located on both incidences on the street corner, one in front of a gas station, one in front of a Sears. And on both times, people were giving all kinds of money. We made a lot of money for local SPCAs doing that. Yay. So I'm sure that she's bringing a lot of attention to this killer whale. And that's why I want to talk to her. So make sure that
I'm trying.
Come hell or high water, we need to talk to her. Okay. Not high water.
Bathtub water.
Bathtub.
Come hell or pruny skin?
Yes. Lori, what are you working on over there in the newsroom?
Well, you know how we like to celebrate the connection between you and your pets on Animal Radio. We love to do that by telling you about celebrities, too, who, you know, they're just like us. And
they're just like
getting
us.
Getting a new pet. Well, you know, except their bank account. <Yes.
laughs> Minus that. They're just like us.
Right.
So someone's getting new pets?
They got a new pet, and how they posted it, and it's a really cute puppy.
I'm looking forward to that. I hear Bieber's getting another monkey. Which,
that's a shame.
Yeah, that really is a shame.
Really?
Yeah.
Didn't somebody already do that in the 80s? That's been done.
Well, he got one, and then he got rid of it.
Well, gave it to he had to give really? It up. Yeah. It was confiscated because he went to a different country, and then he decided... He didn't want to pay all the money and all the fines. He just let it go.
Can I say he's a moron?
Anyone... moron.
You're going to have believers calling you in protest.
Okay, you Bieber believers, dial now. I'm ready.
You're listening to Animal Radio. Call the Dream Team now at 1-866-405-8405.
Hi, this is Joy Behar on Animal Radio. Please spay and neuter your pets.
This is an Animal Radio News Update, brought to you by Doctors Foster and Smith Pet Pharmacy, with prescription medications and over-the-counter products like Advantix flea and tick medication delivered right to your door. Learn more at fosterandsmith.com.
I'm Lori Brooks. If you've ever bought Blue Buffalo, the line of pet food, natural pet food supposed to be for your pet, a new $32 million lawsuit means the pet food maker might owe you money. Blue Buffalo reached the huge settlement over claims that its products were free of poultry byproducts and did not contain wheat, soy, artificial colors and flavors or preservatives. Now, laboratory testing, on the other hand, did show that Blue Buffalo did contain byproducts, which then led to charges of mislabeling and, of course, false advertising, and a big class action lawsuit. Blue Buffalo has denied any wrongdoing, though. It blames a former supplier for the issue, but said it settled the lawsuit not to admit anything, but in order to avoid further litigation expense. So, anyhow, if you bought Blue Buffalo food for your pet in the past, you can go to petfoodsettlement.com if you want to file a claim. Now, if you happen to still have your receipts from the food, you can get up to a 10% refund, which is capped at $200. But even if you don't have a receipt, you can still get $10. The settlement covers purchases which were made over a 7-year period from May of 2008 to December of 2015. There's a cat in Norway that proves towing a sled is not a job for only a dog. You see, if you have not seen this viral video, you would know, because it shows 2-year-old Jesper the cat pulling his owner on a sled along a mountainside trail. But after being towed for a while, his mom is pretty cool. She puts Jesper on her shoulder where he sits on downhill parts of the trail so she doesn't run over him with her skis. But in typical cat fashion, you know, he is a cat. If the pretty orange boy does not feel like being a sled cat that day, he just flat out refuses, sits there, looks at his mom, and then jumps into her backpack and sits there in the backpack with that happy, you know, smile like I won. And then he gets the day off. Of course, though, Jesper is quite a guy, an adventurer guy, and he has his own Facebook page. And he's, you know, very entertaining. And all of his followers keep up with him on Facebook there with his adventures. He is pretty popular. I'm Lori Brooks. Get more breaking animal news anytime at animalradio.com.
This has been an Animal Radio News Update brought to you by Doctors Foster and Smith Pet Pharmacy. With everyday low prices on products like Quellen and Rimadyl delivered right to your door with a 100% satisfaction guarantee. Learn more at fosterandsmith.com.
Doctors Foster and Smith Pet Supplies have a Vet VIPPS accredited online pharmacy covering all your pet's needs, from heartworm medications and anti-inflammatories like Rimadyl to non-prescription items like canine Advantix flea and tick preventive. Doctors Foster and Smith has your pet covered. We'll even contact your vet for you, all with a 100% satisfaction guarantee. Low prices every day with free shipping on orders over $49. Shop online at fosterandsmith.com because your pet's health and happiness come first.
Did you know canine caviar diets are formulated with common health concerns in mind, such as diabetes, cancer, and kidney disease? You see, canine caviar uses low GI carbs, which reduce hunger and prolong physical endurance. Free of GMO, gluten, hormones, steroids, and antibiotics, canine caviar's five-star dog and cat foods are the only alkaline-based foods in the world, and that promotes a healthy lifestyle for your furry family. Find out more at caninecaviar.com.
Hello, this is Dr. Paul on Animal Radio. The pets are all part of your life. Make them welcome in your life.
You're listening to Animal Radio. If you missed any part of today's show, visit us at animalradio.com or download the Animal Radio app for iPhone and Android.
It's Animal Radio, celebrating the connection with our pets. Toll free 1-866-405-8405 to reach out to the Dream Team. And we'll go back to the phones in just a couple of seconds here. But first, I want to visit with Danielle. How do you pronounce your last name, Dais?
D-A-A-L-S.
Well, how are you doing?
I'm good, thank you. How are you?
Very good. Now, you're sitting inside a bathtub, is that correct?
Correct, yes.
And how many days have you been doing this?
Today is day 17, and I'm doing it for 30 days all up.
I'm sorry, is that Australian or that New Zealand accent? I'm having a hard time. What? How many days?
30 days all up, and today is day 17.
Oh, 17.
Today is day 17, okay. Yeah. Now, why are you doing this?
It's to bring more awareness to cetaceans in captivity, and mainly Lolita, who's been held captive at Miami Sea Aquarium for nearly 46 years.
So now let me translate for those. Lolita, who's a killer whale there at the Miami Sea Aquarium, and that's where you are, right?
Correct, yes.
Okay. She's been in captivity for 46 years, did you say?
It'll be 46 years in August.
Wow. And how big is the tank that she lives in?
I'm not too sure of the exact dimensions. I just know that it doesn't meet current regulations. It's too small.
Okay. Are you getting a lot of attention?
Yeah. Yeah, I am getting a lot of attention. Most of it's good, which is positive. There's a few, you know, that think that she should stay where she is, but they don't realize there's actually like a really good sanctuary plan for her. They think we want to just dump her in the wild, but we actually want to put her into a sea pen and have her retrained how to hunt for herself and things again.
Okay.
Gosh, yeah. How long do they live? Does she have a long life left?
Yeah, well, there's actually an orca out there. Her name's Granny, and she's about 102 years old.
Wow.
Lolita's mother is still out there, and she's about 86 years old.
Wow.
And Lolita's the oldest living orca in captivity at the moment. So she's still, you know, she's probably only middle age, so she'd still have a really good life ahead of her in the wild.
Okay. So was she there as a baby?
Yeah, she was captured when she was about 4 years old.
So she probably doesn't know any different, though, does she?
No, the orcas, they have a really good brain capacity. It's about five times the size of ours. And she was played her family's vocals recently, like a few years ago, and she's still reacted towards them, and so she remembers the vocals.
Wow, they can understand. So you're sitting in a bathtub to show that, you know, you're in a confined small space. This is not normal. Is there water in the tub?
No, there's no water.
There's no water in your bathtub?
No.
I would say you'd be approved.
I could do with that some days when it's hot, though.
I bet you wish there was some cool water in there when it's hot.
Oh, yeah.
But you'd be all pruny now anyway. You're from New Zealand, is that correct? Is that where you live right now?
Yes, I do.
So what made this particular killer whale make you come all the way to Miami to do this?
Because once I read about her story and watched the latest Slave to Entertainment, it was just, you know, she's been there for so long, and there is such a really good viable plan for her to be released. And her mum is still there. It would just make the best, happiest ending for her. And, you know, a lot of the other ones, although SeaWorld and such places are still just as horrific. This one, she's been by herself since her last tank mate killed himself. And so it's too small. She can't even dive. She's got no shelter from the sun. And to me, she's in the worst conditions. So I really wanted to do something to help her. And sitting at home signing petitions and following court cases and demonstrations wasn't making me feel like I was really doing anything for her. So I thought I actually need to do something physically. So I came up with the idea to get over here and spend 30 days in a tub.
Do you think it's going to make a difference?
I don't know if it'll make a difference. I'd like to think so, but at least I know that I've tried for her, and I would never be thinking, well, what if I did this? What if I did that? I'd always know that I did something.
What do you normally do for a living?
I work for an airline back at home, and I'm also a mum. I have a 2-year-old son, so I'm pretty busy.
What do your kids think of this?
I only have one, and he's 2 years old, so he's quite a good age to be doing this, where he won't remember mum disappeared for a month, you know.
Well, I encourage you to keep on and go to day 30 if you can. We'd love to hear from you again when you're done.
Oh, thank you so much. Yeah, I'll be doing it. I don't want to have to pull out. I'll regret it if I do, and I want to give it 110% for the leader.
Do you have a website where people can learn more?
Yep, it's called it's www.livinglikelolita.com.
That's livinglikelolita.com. Of course, we'll put links to everything you've heard on today's show over at animalradio.com, and we'll check in with you in about 15 days and find out how things are going for you. I got to tell you, I did something like this. It was to raise money for the SPCA. I lived in a doghouse, but not for a month.
Wow.
Only for a little over a week. So
it's still pretty hot.
I got to say, what you're doing is amazing, and thank you so much for bringing the attention to Lolita.
And does it get any easier as it goes on?
Oh, no, it's getting harder. It's more and more days away from my family, but in a way, it's also more and more days closer, but just got to try and look at the positive, you know?
Well, if there's any time that you feel like cracking, call me, and I'll convince you not to, okay?
You can do it. We're cheering for you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Thank you so much.
Take care of yourself. There she goes, Danielle Dolls. She's living outside the Miami Sea Aquarium in a bathtub to raise attention for Lolita.
Yeah, she wants to show that this is what it's like. That's the kind of space that Lolita has. That's her life, is basically living in a bathtub.
It is very small. I mean, if you look at the picture of Lolita and the tank, I would say there's about 3 times Lolita would be the size of the tank, maybe 4 times.
Yeah, the length. And, you know, these can swim up to 100 miles in the wild, and she doesn't even have a, you know, one.
We'll head back to the phones for your calls for Dr. Debbie and Joey Volani next. Toll free, 1-866-405-8405.
You're listening to Animal Radio. Call the Dream Team now at 1-866-405-8405.
Hi, this is Joy Stewart on Animal Radio. Please spay and neuter your animals. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. It's Robert Semro, your Pet World Insider, here with this week's Animal Radio List, 4 vegetables your kids won't eat, but your pet should. Okay, it's not easy to get your kids to eat healthy vegetables, and it may not be any easier to get your pets to eat them either. But there are some real health advantages to adding vegetables to your pet's diet. Here's a few vegetables that your kids and pets won't want to eat, but they probably should. The first one is a vegetable that even I sometimes turn up my nose at, and that is asparagus. That's right, quick, easy, simple asparagus. Give it a quick warming, cut it into some bite-sized pieces, and you've got a great source of vitamins K, A, B, C, E, as well as folate, iron, copper, fiber, manganese, and potassium. So grab some asparagus and give them a high dosage of health with very little effort. Next up, broccoli. Full of antioxidants, vitamins, and fiber, broccoli has been shunned by kids, pets, and even presidents. But broccoli is a very convenient and healthy choice for your pets. They'll benefit from broccoli in a variety of ways, including many vitamins A, B, C, K, E, folate, iron, copper, fiber, manganese, and potassium. Woo! Steam them up and place a piece or two in with their regular food. And if that doesn't work, try putting it in a blender with a little bit of water and puree it. And voila, you have a broccoli gravy for their meal. Next up, zucchini. That's right, we went to the Z's and found zucchini offers our pets magnesium, potassium, and manganese, which are very healthy for them. The fun part of zucchini is that you can bake it or cook it and add some flavor to it as well as herbs. One of my favorite ways to serve this is to bake it down into zucchini chips. The dogs think they're getting something fun, and I get the satisfaction of serving them a healthy treat. Finally, carrots. Carrots are a great way to provide your pets with some very healthy vitamins and minerals. Steam them or cook them to soften them up, then chop them down into bite size, and you've got a healthy, colorful package. Carrots provide many health vitamins and minerals that can help with eyes, skin, their coat, and even vitality. So grab some carrots. They're a power-packed vegetable that your pets will enjoy and you can have some fun with. Now, I understand that our two-legged and four-legged kids aren't always fans of vegetables. My dog Sugar used to pick out the vegetables and drop them at my feet to show her disdain. But as good parents do, we find a way to have our kids eat healthy. Try throwing lightly steamed or cooked vegetables in their meals on a regular basis. Include it more often in smaller amounts and be creative with additional flavoring to entice them to devour these vegetables. Your pet's body system will thank you. Share your ideas on how to prepare, share, and feed vegetables to your pets on our Animal Radio Facebook page.
Dogs or cats, horse or emu, animals are people too.
You've heard of King Tut. How about King Mutt? Archaeologists have uncovered more than 40 mummified dogs in a 1,000-year-old cemetery south of Lima, Peru. Researchers found 43 dogs buried in separate graves alongside their human owners who seemed to have pampered their dogs like modern owners. There were graves lovingly prepared, often packed with blankets and treats for the afterlife. These uncovered dog graves seem to tell the story of man and man's best friend. I'm Britt Savage for Animal Radio.
Animals are people too. Animal Radio.
You're listening to Animal Radio. Call the Dream Team now at 1-866-405-8405.
Hi, Dora.
Hi, how are you?
Good. I have Dr. Debbie right here. What's going on?
Okay, well, I have a question. I have my dog. He's a Jack Russell mixer with Chihuahua.
Uh-huh.
He's more or less like 10 years old, and he has like a ear infection. So he has like, every time he walks, he shakes his head. So I feel like he has like kind of water inside his ear. He has brownish, like kind of black outside his ears.
Kind of looks all like what I call Oreo cookie crumbs coming out of the ear.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. And does it smell?
Yes.
All righty. Does he have any other problems on the rest of his body, scratching, chewing, anything, or is it just his ears that seem to be bothering him?
Just his ears.
Well, this would be something where if I had your baby right here, I would definitely put one of my little otoscope cones, which is basically a way we look down a doggy's ear canal. My guess is I probably wouldn't see a lot, because if we're having that much garbage coming out of the ear, we've got a pretty bad infection going on of some sort. So the question is, what kind? And generally, what we veterinarians will do is we'll take a sample of it and look under the microscope and see what we've got. With that kind of description of having this kind of Oreo cookie crumb looking stuff, you know, it's pretty open game of what's causing that. We could have something like ear mites, which are little microscopic critters that are itchy beyond all reason. So that would certainly explain why he might be shaking his head. Yeah. And that can be detected by taking a sample and looking. But other causes, bacteria as well as yeast, can commonly kind of take hold of the inside of a dog's ear and really take advantage of that if the environment's right. Dog ears are dark and moist down inside there, so it is just an environment that if the scales tip in the wrong direction, it's not hard for them to get an infection of that kind. So I would certainly say a trip to the vet and getting a sample of that would be first and foremost on my list. But there is a kind of a quick and simple thing you can do. If you can get a small little piece of this material, you can put it on a piece of white paper, take a little bit of hydrogen peroxide and spray it on there. Now, if we have real blood, it'll actually bubble and fuzz and do that kind of thing. If it doesn't, that tells us, ew, this is some real icky grit. This is some material, some kind of product of an organism, and we really need to, investigate along that pathway. Either which way, I think in your baby's case, we really need to get some good cleaning on that ear, get a good look down there, and get a sample. Because, yeah, if he's shaken, you know, that's kind of like us walking around tipping our head to the side. You know, there could be water, but it's probably more than water. It's probably this material, kind of a congestion and an irritation that's causing him to do that. So, yeah, I would certainly say let's see the vet, get some medication going. And then in many cases, once we get past an ear infection, there's some things you can do to try to help prevent that down the road. And there are some very good cleaners that help to keep the environment of the ear canal so that these kind of critters don't take advantage of that. And we can kind of keep that from happening in the future. But, you know, when you say you got a Jack Russell mix, the other thing we think of is these guys have a lot of skin problems, a lot of allergy problems, at least where I come from. So sometimes it can even be just some really bad allergies that cause the pet that degree of discomfort with the ear. So I'd say let's sign up for a good ear exam and see what we need to get going inside that ear canal.
Okay.
Thanks, Dora. Yes. We appreciate your call today.
Thank you so much.
1-866-405-8405 to connect with any one of the Dream Team right now. And let's take a call for Joey Villani. We have BJ on the phone. Hey, BJ.
Hey, Hal. Joey.
BJ.
Will, I love you on Dogs 101. I love it. I just watch you because it's so cool.
Thank you.
I have a Boston terrorist, and he gets dirty ears between his bathings, and so I went and bought some ear wash. I want to deep clean his ears, but how do I do that? Because my groomer says that his ears are dirty.
Well, there's a couple of ways you could do it. Let me ask you, what kind of ear cleanser do you have? Do you know the name by any chance?
Royal Treatment.
Royal Treatment. Okay. It's one that I haven't heard of. If I see it and read the ingredients, possibly, because you want to be careful. A lot of these ear cleaners you should just use on a cotton swab and wipe out the ear. But if you go to your veterinarian, you can get something called OdiCleanse, which works real good. Now, let's just say that you can't get to your veterinarian and you just want to do something in between. What you could do is get yourself a container of witch hazel. They usually come in like 16 ounces, I believe, the one that you get in a regular drugstore.
Okay.
Some tea tree oil, and you're going to add, and when I say tea tree oil, it's essential oil. You don't want to get a blend of anything. Tea tree oil, what it'll do, it'll kill any fungus or bacteria. And you're going to put 20 drops of that tea tree oil right into that witch hazel. What you'll do is you'll take a dropper and just put 2 to 3 drops in each ear. Massage the base of the ear, okay? Let him shake his head. Wipe it out with a cotton swab, and that'll work wonderfully. Actually, it's something that I use in a grooming salon all the time, and
okay.
That should take care of your problems and keep the ears clean. Do they have an odor?
No, because I'm always kissing him on the nose and snuggling him, so I've never smelled it. And I know if it smells, there's ear mites.
Well, not necessarily ear mites, but it could be a start of infection, so that's good that you don't smell anything. But you know what? This will keep his ears squeaky clean. So there you go, and best of luck with your dog. I Boston Terriers are one of my favorites.
Aren't they so cute?
They really are.
Okay, it's time for us to get on out of here. Thank you so much for joining and calling in. Remember, if you need your fix during the week, head on over to animalradio.com or download the Animal Radio app for iPhone and Android, and we'll catch you next week right here for more Animal Radio. Have a good one.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye, and Wolf from my pack to yours.
This is Animal Radio Network.